Okay, so this is where we ended our discussion last day, where we started off. Can both of you can come this side? So basically, when you are discussing on GSM architecture, this happens to be the four major subsystem that we have, in which in fact the mobile station part is pretty much done with, because here we have discussed a lot with respect to the IMEI, the IMSI, the MSISDN, okay, how the numbers are being recognized for that matter. So that part we are leaving out for the time being, because architecture wise, GSM architecture usually happens to be within the other three, which is the BSS, the NSS and the OSS layer. So these three are the major part of it. Most of you, those who have done internship in BSNL and many other telecom operator like Airtel usually gives a very hands-on for this wireless communication, they might be aware of all these subsystems for that matter, because this becomes a very generic discussion on there. Here we will go for a little bit of detail of all the modules that we have. Primarily there's two reasons. One is this being GSM, you will soon find that GSM and GPRS, okay, the packet switching network, they will all have the same architecture. Both of them will have the very similar architecture. In fact, GPRS will definitely depend on GSM architecture to function. So that's why knowing the knowledge or the keeping the knowledge of GSM is very, very important. And it's a very robust architecture for that matter. So that's one thing. And as for the practical sense is concerned, this happens to be a very, very important important topic, I would say, for your term end. Because definitely you can expect a 1 of 10 marks of a question that might come between this architecture part. It's a bit theoretical, but the more better way you represent the whole thing, the more marks you are supposed to score. We'll solve the numericals and the type of different types, we'll solve it on Friday. But for the timing, let us see the theory of it, okay, and the basic architecture behind GSM. So since we have discussed, I think we started off with this diagram, and this in fact gives us a quite an understanding of what are the different subsystems we have. Now as you can observe, the base station subsystem, or the BSS we call it. So if you consider the BSS lies somewhere here, okay. So till this dotted line, the vertical dotted line, is what we are calling as the BSS or base station subsystem. Now whenever you are calling something as a subsystem, it means it contains some modules, then that's why it is called as a subsystem. So in this case, the basic modules that we comprises of a BSS are the MS, the device that is we are looking at, the BTS or the base transceiver system, and the BSC or the base station controller. Now as you can observe from the diagram, it's quite evident that multiple BTS can be connected to a single BSC. And as I told you that for a city where there are multiple number of people gathering in, flocking in, well naturally you will require more and more number of BTS to cover. Because for obvious reasons like the cell sectoring, like the cell splitting, we have discussed that in cellular architecture. So the more you make those base stations ready, the more handier it gets to access all these users. So the more BTS that you are connecting for a particular network, they are supposed to be governed by BSC or a base station controller. You will see the details of those links. There are specific names to the links between BTS and BSC, as well as the BSC where it connects to MSC. We'll see that a bit later. So this is what the function of a BTS and a BSC is all about. As you can observe, the connection between BSC and MSC is not a single connection. There are multiple BSCs which actually gets connected to an MSC. So you can observe this BSC, even this BSC and this BSC, all are connected to a single MSC. So there can be multiple BSC for a given region, depends on the density of population for a particular city. The more demand of mobile service, the more the complexity will become. But this is a generic discussion on all the topic. So this comprises of the base subsystem, base station subsystem, or BSS subsystem. Okay. Now going further, we'll come to detail of this later. First, let us describe this diagram. We'll go one by one. Now we come to the second half of it, and you can see there are two part which is together in the same segment. And this is one part which is the NSS or network switching subsystem, we call this as NSS. And you can see OSS or the operational part is also inside what we call as the NSS part. So you can see that mostly all of this communication, whatever we are happening over the entire network, is governed by MSC itself. So MSC becomes the key holding factor in any network. If you go back to earlier some earlier slide, something of this nature, if I go back to this slide, if you see, that's a bird's eye view of the architecture of GSM. We have observed that the green part is the overall GSM for a given region, but MSC happens to be the biggest region under which the base station controller, the location area identifier, the cellular BTS, all are inside. But we haven't discussed what is inside MSC. So this network subsystem is actually giving us a brief idea about what are the database that we usually associate with MSC. Now, as you can observe, there are primarily in this diagram, as per this diagram, there are three primary registers or database that are of concern. And the one is HLR, the other one is VLR, and the third one is AUC. These three plays a very, very important role in making sure that there is a proper communication being happening between a transmitter and receiver. Now this HLR, basically this happens to be the home location register. Please remember the short form and the full form of this. Okay, home location register. Now what is the function of this home location register? From the name, can anyone suggest me what it can offer to us? Home location register, from the term itself, what do you mean by a home location register? Absolutely, it's basically the network in which you are hooked on to. Suppose I have purchased an Airtel SIM card or Airtel Tamil Nadu SIM card for that matter. So somewhere down the line, the Airtel HLR will hold, or the Tamil Nadu HLR will hold my number as the valid subscriber. So whenever I am trying to make a call, or someone else is trying to make a call to me through that number, always a check will be made where it will be mentioned that I am an authorized or a subscribed user for that particular network. So there won't be any problem at all. So those feature is concerned with the HLR. So whichever network you consider, whichever network or the operator you consider, there supposed to be an HLR which will hold the internal database of the number of subscribers that it holds. It can be Airtel, it can be Jio, it can be Vodafone, whatever it is, but HLR holds the permanent address. You can consider that way. Whereas the visitor location, so VLR is known as visitor location register. This happens to be the register that holds the roaming users. I told you last day as well that when we are traveling from our Tamil Nadu to our native place, naturally we become a roaming user to my native place. Okay, so now, for example, as I was telling you that I am having a SIM card of Tamil Nadu Airtel. Now I am still within the HLR region of Tamil Nadu, but suppose I am going back to Kolkata. So Kolkata Airtel VLR will hold my number as a temporary number. Okay, so that VLR, so VLR of Airtel Kolkata will have a number that will look very similar to my number, but it will be only stored in VLR. So if at all any authentication, any billing, any verification, whatever you call it, needs to happen, MSC will redirect the call towards VLR, not HLR. That is the call which is happening back in Kolkata. Because I am a roaming user, my number, my database or my information will be stored in VLR. And the time being, when I am there in my native place, it's there in VLR. Now suppose I am moving back. Okay, so all this information collected by Airtel Kolkata VLR will be supplied back to Airtel Tamil Nadu HLR. So that's a very small difference between the registers, but it creates a lot of difference in the overall operation. So HLR is primarily
the constant or the permanent one, permanent users
who are registered for a particular network,
whereas this visitor location is nothing but the roaming customer.
So it might be that currently, suppose there is some event going on in my native place, or for matter in any place. Suppose, for example, in Mysore there is a very famous Dasara festival that will happen next month. So there is a lot of people that will flock into Mysore. All are like roaming users. Suddenly the VLR of Mysore Airtel, maybe if we take Airtel as an example, Mysore Airtel VLR will have a lot of people who are having a roaming number. So they will be given a temporary number for those people, for those timing. And after these people comes back to their respective native place or respective HLRs, the VLR Mysore will send all this data to those corresponding HLRs, so that the billing and the authentication and verification is perfect. So that's what the VLR and the HLR, the major, very small difference, but it's a heavy difference. So be very careful in using both this, because all this HLR, VLR or the short form that you are using, they all mean differently. So don't confuse with HLR and VLR, or for that matter for any other register. Now coming to the third one, that's supposed to be one of the very, very important register, and that is known as AUC or Authentication Center. This is supposed to be the authentication center for the particular network. So authentication center is nothing but, suppose I insert a SIM card. I was telling you last day that for the first time when we are inserting a SIM card and everything is getting verified, so those information, it might travel something like it goes to BTS, it goes to BSC, BSC transferred the call to MSC, MSC will dictate that whether it is an HLR, and if anything comes from HLR, it will go and send it to AUC, stating that HLR has confirmed the number. Now you go and verify it further, that whether this call can be established or this user is a valid customer to continue with the call. So all this authentication process is done in AUC. Even suppose I, in some cases, nowadays it's not that relevant, but still, if you can remember, in some cases we had to recharge something, okay? We had a pack, power recharge we call it, where the call rate would come down. Now suppose I don't have that recharge. So naturally the call that I make will definitely cost more. So all those information will be checked in that AUC. Okay? So based on that, some notification will be sent over to both HLR as well as to MSC, stating the same, that this particular user has this particular drawbacks or shortcomings, whatever you call it. So that process is done in AUC. So that's why these three registers are very, very important with respect to network switching subsystem. Now why suddenly the term comes as network switching subsystem? Why is the switching term? Switching is nothing but, because it's done by MSC. Because you can observe that if we go somewhere here to MSC, there are three ways in which the signal might propagate. One is it can go to this direction, it might go in this direction, as well as it can go to this direction. So there are three possible ways in which the signal can be rerouted. That is the primary role of an MSC, to control everything or to switch over the axis. And it is primarily doing that by holding at the center of the architecture. Now suppose even what happens, so along with that there is another register which is missing in this diagram. I will come to that later. We have a scenario where a call is being established from a device or from a mobile device, and it's called to a landline number, right? So you have to connect to some PSTN, not a GSM. It's a landline connection. So you can see in the right hand side you have the output as PSTN. So who will switch over this connection? MSC will be. The switchover between the transmitter side, if you consider, to the respective output is done using MSC. MSC being some intermediate switching device. Okay. And here a powerful one, because it is controlling so many operations altogether. And whatever happens within a network, MSC must know. MSC must be having a knowledge of whatever happening inside the architecture. Last but not the least is OSS, which is the last of the network part, and that is known as the operational support subsystem. Now again, that is primarily, it again deals with the billing process, it deals with kind of a little bit of that how the mobile station is behaving, how the BTS or the BSCs are behaving. Because suppose in remotely placed BTS is not working, if there is some power failure, so this OSS, suppose that particular BTS, naturally it will create a beacon saying that there is a fault in the BTS. Now that information is shared to MSC once again. Now MSC, without giving the order or giving the request to HLR, VLR or AUC, it will redirect the call to OSS. OSS will detect the whole operation and it will detect that at what particular location or at particular what specification of BTS does there is an error. Hence it will notify to MSC once again that there is an error at this particular location of this type. So go and check it or go and resolve it. So an engineer should be sent over there and necessary actions need to be taken. So this type of work is done using that OSS layer. In that, the operational maintenance is OMC. We call that operational maintenance cell. So that's why OMC is called. There are multiple OSS. That's why within OSS there can be multiple OMC. So that is not given. It's just a visual diagram of it. So the left hand side of BSS is clear to us. The middle portion, which is the most important, was is also clear to us, the NSS portion. And we have the right hand side where there is an output. Now output can be anything, as I told you, it can be another GSM network, it can be another PSTN network, it can be another ISDN call, okay? So ISDN basically is the same, or it can be a data network as well. So who controls that? That's the biggest question. Now this particular diagram, and now coming to the diagram, this particular diagram, if you follow, this is given in wrapper code, okay? But there is a shortcoming to this diagram. That's why I would prefer you to apply or use this particular diagram. It's the same diagram, but it's a different way of representation, nothing more than that. But two things are very important in this. You can add that, in fact, in the earlier diagram as well. You can modify the earlier diagram, no problem with me. So, but here you can see, can you identify any specific difference in the registers or the element in the architecture compared to what we have discussed so far? Any two or three specific changes? One, EIR is new. So this is my EIR. So this is my EIR, which is not present in the earlier diagram. And anything else? GMSC, that's correct. So this is something, a new entity that comes in over here, which is not present over there. Now the two functionality, EIR we have already explained, equipment identity register, which actually holds the IMEI number of each and every device. So it actually comes under AUC kind of, so that's why probably in Rappaport it was given under AUC. Okay, that is a case. But ideally if you want to segregate it, it will look something of this nature. Understood? So EIR is basically for the IMEI numbers, the verification that the device is authentic or not. Coming to GMSC, this is called as Gateway MSC. From the term itself, it's quite obvious that it is basically a gateway to connect to the other part. Now, as we already discussed, suppose a mobile phone or a mobile device is trying to call another device. Now, primarily we will consider this time that it's a GSM network, it's a voice call. So from one GSM to another GSM, the one that we have done, I guess, in your lab also. In that case, what is happening ideally, that it should go through some switch in order to make that decision. So suppose this arm, it goes to another GSM network. So a call is established from some place here. Okay, suppose this is my position A, and suppose a device is connected somewhere here, which is as position B. But that position B is some other GSM network. So the bridging between one MSC to another or from one GSM network to another GSM network is done using this gateway MS. Now you will soon find that when we discuss on GPRS, the architecture for GPRS, GPRS, if you remember, is the first of its kind where the data packet was accessed of very low rate, but the data packets were accessed. So this is GSM, we only have voice. GPRS was the first thing that came, the first concept was conceived, that there is a chance that we can packetize the data and we can opt for a data communication. So suppose what will happen, you will soon find that the user is offering a data connection, or if the user wants to have a data connection. So what will happen, this GMSC will reroute the call to some other place where there will be a GPRS network somewhere. So this switching amongst the network is done using this GMSC. Understood? Even suppose, for example, you are trying to call a PSTN number, which is not a GSM nor a GPRS. So it will redirect the call to something of a PSTN which is placed over here. PSTN is nothing but the public switching telephone network, which is a wired line connection. This is a wireless, that's a wired, but the connection is bridging established using GMSC. So whenever you are explaining this, you have to draw this or the earlier diagram. If you are drawing the earlier diagram, please include EIR and GMSC in that. Because if you go back to this diagram, the same thing was there, but somehow in this particular part, GMSC was missing. So if you can include that and you can remodel the diagram, it's fine with me. Or otherwise you can actually have this diagram to explain. Explanation wise, these are the parts to be included. We'll go a little bit detail for some portions now. Okay, so let's see what happens. Is there any doubt with any of the component as of now? This is still the briefing part of all the modules. This is sufficient to know for you. But is there any doubt with any of the operation or the functionality of each of these modules? If not, then maybe we can opt for the specific part which I told you, that this is the base station subsystem. Already we have discussed most of the parts, so I can skip that easily. So skipping this, if I go here, two things are very important which I would like you to note down somewhere. One is known as the Abyss interface. Now what is Abyss interface? You can see here it's mentioned. Abyss interface is the part, Abyss interface is the connection that is established between BTS and BSC. So BTS and BSC. So if I mark this as a tick mark somewhere, so this type of a connection is done using Abyss interface. Please note down this term of Abyss interface. Whereas the connection between BSC and MSC is done using an A interface. So if I just mark it using some other color. So the red arrow is indicating Abyss interface and the blue arrow is indicating an A interface. So these two are very important in knowing. So you can see here that A interface allows a service provider to use the base station and switching equipment made by different manufacturers. So it's basically, when you are looking at this scenario, the information sharing is done through this interface. That's what all about, right? So this is all about, because here after this we have the NSS, where all the information is being transferred, as all the other modules I have already discussed what are the registers and all. So again, this is in detail a bit more. As you can see here, the first point is important. HLR has entries for every subscribers and every mobile number which has its home as its respective network. Please remember this using the examples that I gave you. Then it's easier to explain. Don't just mug up and just come and deliver it. You will mix it up. Just remember it with respect to examples, because this is, these portions are very informative in a way, because in day-to-day life, we experience all these features. Like we become a roaming user, we become a normal user. So that is very much used to. So please remember that. So HLR is this,
Whereas for VLR, you can see there's one very important word. The all mobile station, it stores the data of all mobile stations which are currently staying in the administrative area of the associated MSC. Currently staying, not permanently. For the timing, it's there within the region. After some time, it might leave. Okay. So this is all about the VLR. AUC and OSS, I told you, the authentication center and the verification that usually happens. And you can see here the first point is very important. It's a very strongly protected database, because all and every checking of your number, okay, with respect to the verification and like connection, okay, or everything goes in between that AUC. And you can see here that also the EIR, see here it's already mentioned. This is taken from Rapaport. AUC holds the information of EIR. So ideally, in the diagram that Rapaport has given, they has considered that EIR is a part of AUC itself. Okay? So anyone you can use, but it's better to segregate each and every block and express file. Okay? So that's all about AUC and OSS. And MSC, as you all know, that as I told you, the main block set of the architecture, which holds and reroutes everything and controls everything. It's basically the CPU of the network, or I mean overall network. It's processor, okay, basically. So, and also the GMSC, as I already explained, so nothing much. In fact, I have explained more compared to these points. Okay, so that in fact concludes the discussion on the architecture. So one thing to be very sure, in whenever you are explaining the architecture, diagram is a must. Okay. Use proper labeling so that each and every component of that architecture is clearly visible. Okay. For that, I would prefer you to draw it using a device which was there from ancient time called as pencil. Okay. And there is another device called rubber to erase something. So use those very predominant, premature techniques to draw the diagram, and then explain each and every module, and that will be it. Right? So I'll upload these portions, as well as you can refer to any books. Again, many materials I'll be uploading anyway. But if you find anywhere that you can find some extra inbuilt points for all these matters, please include that to your answers. Because the point is, you all will be writing the same thing. So the one that is something different to the other is what, and if it is correct, that is, we will give preference to that answer.
Sir, so if you have given a question from this section, how would the question be framed exactly?
Basically, it will be mentioned like, using a suitable diagram, explain the GSM architecture.
That's 10 marks.
That's 10 marks. Flat.
So you would explain BSS.
BSS, NSS,
OSS.
You can also include a bit more for the MS with respect to IMEI and UZ, a little bit of information, not in details, just a briefing of it, and you end up with GMSC and MSC, what you expect. It comes under NSS, yes.
So the total.
That's all. So now we are going for the last segment, or the segment before CAT 1. Rather, it is the starting of the radio subsystem for GSM. But we'll not go into the detail of it for the time being. Post CAT 2 will come back and we'll go for the radio channels and the model. Although it is a bit theoretical and it's kind of a boring, I know. But unfortunately, it's there in the syllabus, so we have to finish that. But that is not there in your CAT 2. So we'll finish off the portion which are there in your CAT 1 for the time being. Okay? And that's very interesting. So please, all of you, please note down the segment that I'm giving over here, with the specifications given. First of all, because each and every line will carry a meaning, and if you don't understand the meaning, please tell me, because all of these are standard. It's not given by me. It's a GSM standard which happens to be for all throughout globe it is maintained. Even in NetSIM, if you can go back and at some point you can search, all the specifications will be given in NetSIM as well. Okay? And you have done your experiment with standards of this nature. So the first thing is that GSM utilizes two bands of 25 megahertz, which has been set aside for a system using for all member countries. So wherever GSM is occupied, wherever GSM is followed,
which in most cases in globally, if you consider in most of the region it's there, we will follow our this particular nature. Now what is 25 megahertz? You can see the uplink and the downlink frequency. So this is my uplink frequency band, 890 to 950. Okay, so this is my uplink and this is my downlink. Okay, so this is 890 to 915 and this is 935 to 960. That's why we usually refer to, colloquially we call it as 900 megahertz of stereo band. The same thing, that's only because it operates around that 900 megahertz. So this is the range of frequency. And one thing to be very honest with you, I put a star on this, and like in many of the cases, in some of the cases, like in famously called by someone over in TV and all that, ever, never, ever, never, ever forget about something, right? So like that, never, ever, never, ever forget about the uplink and downlink of GSM, okay? This is a must. For any wireless scenario, if suppose you are going for your project Viva, if you are going for your placement, you will be asked a simple question. You have read wireless, tell me the uplink and downlink frequency of GSM. This is the frequency. Don't go for any other values. They are all wrong. And for people who are coming for your interview, they won't even remember other things. Only they will remember this one. So don't ever forget about this. So these are your uplink and downlink. Now, where come the 45 megahertz comes in? You can see here, two frequency bands of 45 megahertz apart have been reserved for GSM. So let us see with a diagram. We'll come back to the other specifications. So this is a diagram for you. Now as you can observe, the 45 megahertz happens to be the starting of 890 to the starting of 935. So the least point of uplink to that of the least point of downlink, this gap is considered to be 45 megahertz. That's the separation given. And the difference between the uplink and the downlink, uplink and downlink, the maximum range is given by the 25 megahertz. So this is quite clear, I think, from the diagram itself. No, this is where it starts actually. 890 is here. Okay, this is the overall, this is our 935. So if you're considering this as 45, this is actually supposed to be, if you go back, yeah, okay, it's given over here. So 890, 935, what is the difference? 935?
It's 45.
It's 45, right? So it's diagram wise, it's a bit, maybe an error, but basically it's a 935 and 890. What is the difference between that is 45. And in between 890 to 915, what is the difference? 25 megahertz. Now amongst this 25 megahertz, there are 125 single carriers that might be present. That's been mentioned over there. So 25 megahertz is subdivided into 125 single carrier channel. Now if you divide 25 by 125, 200 kilohertz is what you are getting, and that is called for the ARFCN or the least channel spacing for GSM. If I go back once again, you can see here the each uplink and downlink is separated by not that one. This 200 kilohertz band is called as the ARFCN. So basically, if you consider this nature of frequency deviation or distribution of frequency band, so 200 kilohertz is what is allotted. But you will soon find that 200 kilohertz will also be distributed amongst 8 time slot. So first thing to remember, 25 megahertz is the separation amongst the uplink and the downlink, maximum and minimum. 45 megahertz is the separation between the minima uplink and the minimum of downlink. 200 kilohertz is the carrier frequency or the minimum carrier frequency for per individual slot, that's the channel spacing of 200 kilohertz. 125 single carrier is used in this case. Now this happens to be one of the information. You can see here it's single carrier, but you will soon find when we go for higher order modulation based multiple access technique, which is an OFDMA, this single carrier will lead to multi-carrier modulation. There will be multiple number of carriers that will simultaneously modulate the data. That is why the data rate will go high. That is why when you are going for 3G and beyond, GSM architecture fails. Because for more and more data rate, you need multiple number of carriers, which is not supported by GSM itself. We'll discuss that later. So this is one half. Second half of our discussion is this. This is also very important. Instead of this, maybe I can just show you this diagram. This I think will be easier. So this is the uplink and the downlink given to you. Just a pictorial representation. The top one is the downlink. The below, the middle one is what is up. Sorry. So this is my uplink. Now you can see what they have pointed out here is, this is my 200 kilohertz. 1200 kilohertz if I consider. Amongst this 200 kilohertz, you have 8 time slots. This is what we call as GSM TDMA frame. It cannot be more than 8, but you can multiply number of frames in order to make the frame to look bigger. We will go for hyper frame, super frame, like that. We will go on. But that is different. We will discuss that later. Post-CAT2 we will discuss. But to understand this, so 200 kilohertz is separated into 8 time slots. Each of this time slot, if you consider, okay, if each of this time slot, like here they have zoomed on 3. This time slot has a duration of 577 microseconds. Please note down all the specification as given here. Now I come back to this diagram. So as you can see, 200 kilohertz is carrying 8 TDMA frames. So this is what the frame is. 200 kilohertz. So these are the 8 TDMA frames. Each of these frame contains, so this is one frame. The total 7 slot contains one frame. Okay. So rather I would say these are all 8 frames they consider. These are all 8 frames. Okay. Now each of these frames will contain the data. So they can actually can access 8 subscribers. You can see there, third point, each of these 8 subscribers occupies a unique time slot. So if that is the case, the time slot, time duration for this is becoming 577 microseconds. So this is my approximate 577 microseconds. Understood? Each of the 200 kilohertz is separated into 8 frames. One frame contains 8 slot. You can consider this as one frame. Okay, this is one frame. This is my one frame. It contains 8 time slots. Now each of these time slots are given by 577 microseconds. So if you have 8, so you multiply that. So you get around 4.615 millisecond as a frame duration. You can see there, one TDMA frame spans for 4.615 milliseconds. Again, a constant, a standard, you cannot really go on altering this. Whatever, wherever you are making any network, you have to follow these standards. Right? Now, within this slot, so these are my slot. Just to clarify once again, these are my slot. And this whole thing is one frame. So within one frame, we have 8 slots. Okay? And each of these slots are having 577 microseconds of duration. You multiply 8 slot with that, it will come around 4.615. Now, see what I did here. 4.615 is now clear. Now, this is a frame duration. Now, if I go back to the individual slot, they can be distributed in this pattern. The pattern of this and the detail of this will come back post CAT 2, not now. Just for the timing, you understand that what is the total number of total bits? Can you count that? How many total number of bits are there? 3 bits, 57, 1, 26, 1, 57, 3. So just count how many? 148.
So we happens to be 148. It happens to be 148 bits plus as standard 8.25 guard band to be used. These are guard bits. You can see here the guard space is given, but it's not specified how many. But basically, this happens to be 8.25. So if you add this two, this comes to be 156.25 bits. So this is again another standard that you cannot go beyond 156.25 bits.
Start and stop
it
also.
Yes. Start and stop it is there. S, you can see there. The S part here. This is actually signaling that whether it should be used for a control information or a voice communication.
Okay.
We'll discuss that. That's why I'm not going into that. You have to understand controls channels for GSM, then only you will understand this. But this is total 148. But just see within 148, the useful data are only 57 multiplied by 2. Because the tail bit or the S, whatever is written, they are not carrying any information. They are all redundant data. So the information that is only carrying is for 57 bits. So your data, whatever you are sending, data means the voice in this case, voice that you are sending over, it will be segmented into those 57 bits. So per slot, 8 users can only use. So first user comes in, if first slot is empty, he is given the first slot. He goes on in this pattern, his particular data gets segregated and he starts to communicate. Second user comes in, it will come to second slot, third, fourth, five, six. Like that, 8 user is at max. When the 9th user comes in, it has to wait because the 8 slots are already filled. So what we can do is, we can go on extending this number of frames. That's where the super frame or hyper frames will come in. We will try to offer the user more and more number of spaces so that it can come and communicate. Otherwise, there will be an indefinite period that it has to wait. So that portion we'll discuss later.
So that is what we have discussed over here. So you can see
156.25 channel bits in which 8.25 bits are the guard band. Okay.
So that's more like it. Finally, to conclude with this one, you can see two things to be important. One is the overall data rate. Please note it down. The GMSK modulation, which you all discussed even, 270.833. This is actually the GSM, the total overall channel data rate. But this is the total theoretical maximum. This needs to be divided into slots because there are 8 time slots, 8 users suppose.
So this divided by 8, you can see here I did it. So this divided by 8, so per user the data becomes almost 33 kbps, which is not sufficient for a valid data connection. That is one of the reason why GSM doesn't support a GSM data communication. Okay, because this is a very meager data rate that you are looking at.
And another thing is that the practical data rate or the transmission rate will come down to 24 kbps, even less. So as you can observe, the more number of users, more demand, and the data rate will definitely come down. So these are the some of the statistics which are very, very evident and is important. So what we'll do is we'll try to solve some problems related to this. Today, let us finish off in this note, and we'll solve the other problems related to CAT 2. Maybe it will be useful for you.
Thank you. 1 minute.